Good morning, good afternoon, good noon, good evening, wherever you are. Welcome to the third day of our conference. For those of you who are just joining me and all of the group here, I'm Gerald Winslow, Director of the Ethics Center at Loma Linda University, and I help coordinate the work of the Adventist Bioethics Consortium. Really looking forward to today's time together. We anticipate the group will be a bit smaller today, so we've changed the rules a little, and you'll be able to unmute yourself whenever you choose. We ask that you stay muted unless you're speaking, but we think this may facilitate more discussion. I would also encourage you to use the chat function so you can raise questions or make comments. Our devotional is going to be brought to us once again by Dr. Carla Park. I hope you have appreciated and enjoyed her devotionals in the morning as much as I have. I can tell that she's really spent time in prayer and in thought in order to bring these devotional talks to us. So Carla, thank you. Thank you for what you've done. And thank you in anticipation for your thoughts today.
Thank you, Jerry. This is the third devotional talk in a series of three, which all build on each other to suggest aspects of ethics for the ministry of healing, the theme of this conference. First, I discuss the ethic of wonder and the habit of asking questions to deepen understanding, to be seized by wonder and filled with awe. Second, I discuss the intersection of connection and collaboration, suggesting that we never let go of the thread, the cord of three strands bound by the love of Christ. Today, I discuss the importance of embodying culture, the secret to forever, ethics, habits, and culture formation. You will never change your life until you change something that you do daily. The secret of your success is found in your daily routine, John Maxwell. It used to take 21 days to change a habit, or so we thought. Now it takes 66, and some say 91. Have we gotten weaker, or have we only begun to understand the power that habits have? Go to any reunion. We tend to be more of what we were at 17. Some surprises, not many. So if culture forms from the accumulated actions of people, then it seems almost impossible to shift. Whether it's the culture of family, business, or healthcare, it moves steadily, like a river wearing away the land, deepening its path with the flow. Our lives will long be over before the river changes course. Even when the river freezes and appears to stand still underneath the ice, the river continues. How then do we change culture? Carla, could you go see Mr. Bradley? I was a nurse, educator, chaplain, and teaching whole person care to medical students at the time. The referral continued. He was in a vehicle accident and is in traction in room one. He was thrown from the car. His wife called out for him because she was trapped under the vehicle, but he wasn't able to get to her. She died at the scene. And he won't talk to anybody. He won't say anything. This is a river frozen. Hi, Mr. Bradley. My name is Carla. Nothing. I want to know if there is anything I can do for you. I winced. Anything I can do for you? It sounded like something from a grocery store orientation. You can bring back my wife, he said, not looking at me. I felt defeated, but just as I turned to leave, I noticed that he was unshaven. The stubble that I used to rub backwards on my father's face. Empathy pulled me back. Without thinking it through, I leaned close. If you knew that you could see and say goodbye to your wife, would you want to? He turned slowly and looked at me. Yes. Had this been 2021, it would not have been unusual, but it was the late 80s and grief care was young. In my eagerness to help, I had just crossed the line. His physician was with another patient, but I asked for some time before he left the unit. Please talk to me now, he said. I'm in a hurry. Well, I started the patient in room one wants to see his wife. Okay, he said without taking it in, and then, oh, I'll be right out. The physician didn't miss a beat, even though later he acknowledged that he had done everything, never done anything like this. Well, if you can get the body, I'll arrange mirrors above his bed so he can see her. And with that sentence, he became a great leader with moral audacity. A woman at the morgue said, well, the body is here now and belongs to us. Belongs to you? The doctor, nurses, unit secretary, everyone in the hospital unit got on board. Her body did not belong to anyone but her husband and God. At that moment, everyone involved was willing to turn the world upside down, literally with mirrors, to help the husband see and say goodbye to his wife. In the end, rather than see his wife through mirrors, the physician discharged Mr. Bradley early so that he could attend the funeral. It took a few minutes of our time, but it changed his life. Soon thereafter, we developed grief programs, trained staff, and grief care moved into the culture of healing at Loma Linda. The frozen river melted into the current beneath it. What seemed wrong, impossible, even unheard of at the time, became everyday fare within a couple of years, and the river flowed. Ethics for the Ministry of Healing means we form the context in which that kind of ministry, true healing, can and will take place. But how do we do it? Let's follow Paul at Athens for a moment. To shift, change, or strengthen culture requires a leader who takes up a path with moral audacity and walks it every day. Is it 21 or 91? It's a lifetime of days, a rhythm of consistency that can be trusted. When Paul arrived in Athens, in Acts 17:16, the text says he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. That's what he saw, but it is not what he said. What he said was, I see that in every way you are religious. At the same time, he began talking about Jesus and the resurrection. So he's disturbed by something he sees and at the same time finds something in common and connects it to his message. Verse 23, for as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription to an unknown God. This God, whom you worship without knowing, is the one I'm talking about. Then he preaches the biography of God, who this God is, creator, where this God lives, what this God does, how this God acts, and he concludes with, in him, we live and move and have being. Wait, he just quoted their poets. Aratus had written a poem using the phrase, for we too are his offspring. And Cleanthes had written a hymn with the words, for we thine offspring are. So they know this phrase, but it was addressed to Zeus in both cases. Paul has just applied it to a different God, their unknown God, not to Zeus, the father of their gods, but to the only God among no other gods, the creator of everything. Brilliant. The result? Some scoffed, but others wanted to hear more. And some were so convinced that they joined him. The culture begins to shift. The river begins to cut a new path. So what do we have here? A leader who takes up a path with moral audacity, and we are all leaders, who observes carefully those whom he serves, connects with them, collaborates with them on something they want and need, and then embodies the tension enough to accommodate and craft a new reality. But to thoroughly embed it in the culture, it needs repeating. And so we develop mission statements, service standards, policies. We hire for mission. We develop communal gatherings like APA, Adventist Health Policy Association, and this bioethics consortium. And I agree with you, Peter Landless, We need to talk more, come together more, listen better, put our deepest questions in the open, make clear through social media the stories that are true, and carve a place for the right river, because it is that current that will decide the future. And my final poem of William Stafford, Ask Me. Sometime when the river is ice, ask me mistakes I have made. Ask me whether what I have done is my life. Others have come in their slow way into my thought, and some have tried to help or hurt. Ask me what difference their strongest love or hate has made. I will listen to what you say. You can turn and look at the silent river and wait. We know the current is still there, hidden, and there are comings and goings from miles away that hold the stillness exactly before us. What the river says, that is what I say. Forever began yesterday and proceeds after we're gone. We leave the world a better place, not because of what we have done, but because of what the culture has become by having us in it. So patiently, day after day, we embody what we say we believe, and we invite others to do the same, establishing avenues and systems and policies that make it easier and assure that it will continue. It should not be our goal to be liked as much as to craft a culture worth living in. After all, the current will outlast us. The river is the secret to forever. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Lord, embolden us to craft the right river so that mission will never drift, but roll and tumble in the strength after we are gone. Amen.
Thank you, Carla. It's a remarkable blessing, as have been the previous two devotionals for us. Thank you for that. I should have mentioned that Carla is the executive director for Faith Community Strategy at Advent Health Corporate near Orlando, Florida. We're going to take just a short break while we set up here for the next session. So just stay tuned. We won't need to take the 15-minute break or even a 5-minute break. And we will turn to our next session. Thanks to all of you who have been with us all 3 days. I've seen some of you here. So many of you are friends, and I wish I could reach out to the screen and just talk to you for a few minutes. Trust me, we're going to plan to get together in person so we can have those hallway conversations. But as we've done the last couple of days, we will leave the link on all of the time so you can talk with each other either via chat or however you choose to substitute for the hallway conversations. Our convener for the next session is Francisco Cross. Chaplain Cross is the Director of Mission. I'm going to read his actual title, Director of Mission and Spiritual Care at Adventist Health Rideout. We miss his amazing smile at Loma Linda University, where he served as a chaplain for us for a time. Dare I be proud enough to say that he's also a graduate from our graduate program that prepares chaplains. I also want to mention that Francisco leads the ethics program at Adventist Health Rideout, where he's the chairperson of the ethics committee. And so Francisco, please take over and introduce our speakers.
Thank you, Jerry. It's looking at all the faces, it almost seems like a reunion, and I agree with you. I wish I can just touch and embracing the hugs that we once gave, at least when I was at Loma Linda. I can't be remiss to say hello to Mark Carr and Andy Lampkin, who have been professors of mine and Carla. I told her just not too long ago that I actually missed hearing her stories, still powerful, the culture and how to craft a river. Amazing. Thank you. Jerry, I do want to just begin by first saying thank you. You have been a colleague. You have been a mentor to me, and still a mentor and friend. You have given me this wonderful opportunity to share with the speakers, and I'm very, very grateful for it. And I also, I have to take a moment. I think this is something that you actually taught me the first day I walked into your office, and just before stepping in, you stopped me and you turned around and you said a few words to someone who I didn't know at the time, but now I know her very well, Mary Jane. And I'll never forget what you said. This is the glue that holds this department together. You might even said myself. And so Mary Jane, I just wanna say thank you for all the work that you have done behind the scenes to actually make this happen. It's been amazing and very, very grateful. It's hard to believe that it's been 10 years, but over the past few months, it has been difficult, Jerry, as we know. And I have to be honest, Carla, I agree with you that that Peter Landless said something and it's still ringing in my ears. It was sticking with me this morning, and he asked the question, how can we do more together? Creating this craft and culture of collaboration, of networking. And again, I'm happy to say that the Adventist Bioethics Consortium, Jerry, I believe is actually doing just that. It is setting that platform where we can have those dialogues and those very meaningful conversations to teach and inform us how to move forward. This pandemic has caused us to refocus, I believe, and to remember why we've been called to this ministry of healing. We've also been made acutely aware of the inequities and disparities throughout the healthcare system. And I think that our ethical and moral responsibility has been at the top of our agendas more than any other months, dealing with moral tensions across the country and raw outbreaks of racial violence, COVID-19 pandemic, job loss. I can go on and on and on. But perhaps more importantly, it has presented to us this opportunity to lead differently during these very challenging times. But I believe our faith inspires and challenges us to be connected in an authentic way to our communities on a local, domestic, and international level. And so I am honored to say that I get to share some time with some amazing people who have also been both mentors and professors. And I want to begin by just saying this. This pandemic is teaching us that we have to be purposeful and connected to the current needs, and also that our responses must speak boldly to our faith and mission. Our mission speaks to our faith. It speaks to why we do what we do and why we exist. So why Adventist Faith for Health and Ethics? Why is that so important? Why bioethics? I think this is why our discussion today is so valuable. And so today we have the opportunity to hear from some of our leaders that many of you know from our Adventist faith. So for the sake of fluidity, I want to introduce all of our speakers, and then I want to hand it over to my colleague, Alex, so that he can have time and so that we can have time to dialogue amongst each other, and also room for questions. So I'm actually going to begin with introducing Randy Roberts, known to many of us. He currently is the Vice President, Spiritual Life and Mission at Loma Linda University Health, and he also is the Senior Pastor at the Loma Linda University Church. Just a little bit about him. He was born in South America to missionary parents, and he actually graduated from Southwestern Adventist University in Keene, Texas, with a major in theology and a minor in modern languages. Pastored for 5 years in the Texas Conference of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And during that time, he was able to complete his master's of divinity degree at the Theological Seminary in Andrews in Michigan. I can go on and on and say a lot more about Randy, but you will hear him speak after Alex. And I want to introduce our last speaker before I introduce Alex as our first speaker, Angeline Brower. She actually has served as the Health Ministries Director for the North American Division of Seventh-day Adventists since 2016. She holds a Doctorate of Public Health degree in nutrition from Loma Linda University School of Public Health and a Master's of Health and Science and Epidemiology from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. She previously worked at the Seventh-day Adventist Guam Clinic as Wellness Director and Dietitian, and at Johns Hopkins as Senior Research Assistant. As a public health epidemiologist, her role at the NAD includes producing health content on a variety of topics, championing the work of health professionals, training lay members, providing health resources and mentorship for college students, advising NAD administrators and on these health-related issues. Dr. Brower believes that the healthy living should be practical, understandable, and enjoyable for everyone. She believes that the comprehensive health work includes physical, mental, social, and spiritual well-being. And all of us have a vital part to play in the ministering hope and wholeness to our communities. And last but not least, who will soon speak to us after I introduce him, is Alex Bryan, who currently is the Chief Mission Officer at Adventist Health. He oversees mission, identity, and integrity, integration, ethics, clinical chaplaincy, and faith community relations. He's been a college president, church pastor, religion teacher. He holds a BA history, religion, and Southern from Southern Adventist University. Also completed his MDiv at Andrews University, completed also in addition a DMin in George Fox University, and is currently completing his BS at Albany Medical College in bioethics. And last but not least, he loves Randy Roberts. Even though the Randy is a habitual, unrepentant, and sinner as a fan of the Dallas Cowboys. I had to put that one in there just so I can see some smiles, but yes. Alex, thank you so much for taking this on. It is so good to be here in company with you. The time is yours.
Thank you, Francisco. Just what a privilege to work alongside my colleague, Francisco Cross, in our work. Fantastic. Good to see my college dormitory dean, Mr. DeBias, here. And also, yes, I've just dated you, I realize, you were much older than I was. And then members of my congregation, Steve Herber, Meredith Job, my workplace congregation, good to see you in church today. So that's a good thing. So I want to go, I want to talk about Mark Carr to start my remarks. It was 2 to 3 years ago, I reached out to my colleague and friend and said, I really need to grow in my capacity to understand bioethics. This is a part of my portfolio. I need to mature. I need to understand the geography, the vocabulary. Can you guide me with some, frankly, some distance learning because I need to keep my day job where I can slowly develop some skill set here. It's necessary. And the two of us kind of worked together and I landed at Albany Medical College, the Alden March Bioethics Institute. So over the past 2 years, I have immersed myself in things that all of you know well. Whether it's pediatrics or mental health, law, public policy, research, and of course, fundamentals and philosophical underpinnings of bioethics. And I have, 2 years so far and hoping to complete later this year. I chose this particular institution in part because I wanted to go to a place that did not have an Adventist nor a Christian foundation intentionally. I was curious. And I have found, and you will not be surprised, that through all of these various courses, God is never mentioned. God is not a reason, not a foundation. Even in my course on religion and bioethics, merely taught as a way of understanding our patients as they come to us with their own beliefs in various myths. And so it has been good for me to have that particular slant on the education. And I have found myself in the unique position of being perhaps the only among all kinds of lawyers, physicians, and bioethicists to be my classmates. I have found myself, quite honestly, to be maybe the only person of any kind of what you might term conservative faith or Christian faith, which has been fascinating. So I just want to share with you some of my observations, and I'm actually going to share screen here and see if this makes sense just for a couple moments. Do you see a full screen versus the split screen? I think you see a full one.
Yep.
So at the end of one of my first classes, which was a philosophical underpinnings class, you go through the whole class and the ultimate question of why is not asked. So I have screenshotted, Dr. Winslow, I apologize for the low quality here. I screenshotted my paper for you at the top, which was titled, But Why? And I simply asked the question, why are we doing this? Why should we even have this program? Why are we doing bioethics at all? And led, of course, to a short paper for the final, human beings are valuable. That's why we're doing this, basically. And why are they valuable? And suggested the most likely explanation is we were valuable because we were fashioned by a creator. And then this was my response. And I know this is a little small, but this is the response of my professor just 1 week shy of a year ago. Alex, this is a well-written and fascinating paper. I admire your boldness in taking on the fundamental question of ethics, and your style of writing drew me in and made the paper fun to read. So I'm thinking this is good news so far. My criticism, however, and so here it comes, is that the religious system of ethics you settle on at the end is very much up for debate, even among those who agree with you that ethics requires some objective universal footing. There are secular arguments for the value of humanity. Kant comes to mind. His view could be and has been secularized. There are also arguments for certain kinds of relativism that could be addressed. Of course, we didn't discuss these in detail in class, and so it's hard to hold that against you. Still, I think that's where the argument would logically lead, and the thesis, if your thesis had appeared earlier, I suspect you might have had some interesting replies to those potential objections. Anyway, great work, and on he goes. And so I have found it interesting in each class to gently, lovingly, tenderly introduce my philosophical worldview. And for those of you that know me, without proselytizing, but just simply to nudge things along a little bit. Well, this shouldn't surprise us. James Davison Hunter, sociologist at the University of Virginia. This would be 11 years ago, his publication. The presumption of God and his active presence in the world cannot be easily sustained because the most important symbols of social, economic, political, and aesthetic life no longer point to him. God is simply less obvious than he once was, and for most, no longer obvious at all. And this has been my experience over the last couple of years. So I'm going to argue that it is important, and I think Dr. Roberts is going to pick up on some of the specifics. I'm going to argue that it is important what underpinnings we have for our interest in ethics and bioethics, and in the end, it matters. So we can talk about if that is the case or if that's not the case together, but three things very quickly that I think we're trying to engage in our company to help ensure that as we become more diverse, that we are solid in this connection. Number one, telling the great story. 2 years ago, I shared with you a part of this at this very conference. We are telling all of our 37,000 associates again and again in different formats, the great story of God and Jesus and the Adventist version of that story. And you may remember, I'm refreshing you, these title slides talking about the Advent, talking about the Adventist tradition, nourishing all of our folks in the clinical realm, the business realm, everywhere, that we have a master guiding story that undergirds everything. So that's number one. We're going to keep telling the story over and over and over again. Secondly, venturing into this, Dr. Winslow, that we actually might teach the foundations. And here I don't mean the foundations of bioethics from the textbooks that we all love and share, but what comes beneath those textbooks, the ultimate foundations. And so, yes, we have this structure of bioethics that we're building across our system, which you can see here how it's all going to fit together. This build's going on, but underneath it is this, how we're forming, beginning with our executives, a deep understanding. And I'll just guide you to look at the leaves. I'll give you the content later. You can drill down further, but the tradition, all 150 of our executives, give or take, understanding the tradition of Jesus, of Judeo-Christianity, of the Adventist world, ethics, understanding the underpinnings, every executive, no matter where they work, a sense of vocation, and of course, spirituality. But this deep work, a fresh initiative in our company underway, but saying, look, we have to spend some serious time with the people who are making the decisions, who are calling the shots. They need to understand at the deepest level what we're up to. And so, for example, coming in the third quarter of this year, some of you will know my colleague, Sam Lenore. We are teaching Missional Foundations of Adventist Healthcare. A fancy way of saying we're going to have a good old-fashioned Bible study in ways that provide some connection. And then finally, I think it's connecting the work. It's not just telling the story. It's not just talking about what those theological and philosophical underpinnings are for an ethical way of thinking about healthcare, but we've got to connect the work. And ways that we're doing this, whether it's those that guide our investment portfolio, I tell them before you do a presentation, what are the philosophical foundations for why we do investments? What are the theological foundations for why we have a certain compensation strategy? Anywhere in the company, I am urging, in my role as chief mission officer, and urging may be too gentle of a word, I am urging that there be clear connections between why we're doing things as a company in every area and how that fits into core foundational thinking. So that's been actually it's been exciting. And I think that folks that do work, and they may think, no one has ever told me that my work connects to God. It has been a good thing. And I think it's been refreshing. Just one quick example, then I'll turn it over to Dr. Roberts. Some of you will find this playful. A little presentation I did recently called The Red Books and the Blue Zones. And for those of you that don't remember, the Red Books are Ellen White. And this has been a lot of fun. The Red Books and the Blue Zones. Some of you know that we have recently brought the Blue Zones under our roof. And so you can see what we did here. Something that came out of the Red Books because of a theological perspective about humanity, an anthropology, if you will, that came out of the Adventist tradition. Like this one, active exercise, for example. And then you can see what I'm going to do here, and I will not take the time, but show you. And then said, oh, well, the Blue Zones is merely an echo. That's all it is. It's merely an echo of a deeper tradition. And you can see just back and forth, and I'll give you these notes later, and you can see those connections. And this, again, insists upon the fact that we aren't going to launch an initiative or move a new direction without connecting it in a mature way to the why question. And so I will finish with this, and then Randy, the time is yours. Eugene Peterson, I'm rereading this month his Reverse Thunder. The revelation gives us the last word on Christ. And the word is that Christ is center and at the center. We can understand nothing if we do not have a center. If this, quoting Yeats, if this center cannot hold, mere anarchy is loosed upon the world. And so I commend to you the center. And Randy, I'm going to turn it over to you to take us the next leg of the journey. I think you're muted, brother.
Thank you, sir. Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can.
Thank you so much to Dr. Brian. Thank you to Francisco. Thank you to Dr. Winslow, who is a dearly beloved mentor and friend. And to Carla Park for an excellent devotional. I've been trying to think through how to respond to a Redskins fan about the Cowboys, but some things are so obvious they don't need to be stated. So actually, Alex, I'm going to take, after talking and consulting with Francisco, I'm going to take this in a little bit of a different direction in terms of an application and some questions about something that has become very real in my life here in the setting where I find myself. I live kind of on two sides of the sidewalk here. One side of the sidewalk is the healthcare institution and the educational institution. You can see the pictures here. In the foreground is what has become known as the Hart Bypass, in memory of Dr. Hart, but also a bypass that allows our campus to be a walking campus and more unified as one. So one side of the sidewalk is that overall entity. On the other side of the sidewalk is the church, where I'm privileged to be involved as well. And it's a key to my life and to what I do. And I've thought about these two sides of the sidewalk and what we could say at this current time in the midst of this pandemic. As Adventists, we have a commitment to health. I really appreciate, Alex, the creative way in which you brought that together there at the end of your presentation with the red books and the blue zones. Powerful realities that make a lot of sense. That's our commitment. We've had a commitment to health. We've had a commitment throughout our history, or most of it, to religious liberty. And we've had a commitment to readiness for the parousia. Those are three realities that I think can define large segments of Adventism, have been important in our history, and are important in our current time. Well, it seems to me that these three have intersected in this COVID pandemic. I have watched what has happened with great interest and at times with growing alarm. Just watch what has happened in my overall faith community, but in a more specific way here in the area with which I'm most familiar, and have seen dramatically different responses to what those three realities for us are. We all know we're living in a very polarized time, a very divided time in the country, but that is true also in local congregations. And I'm not speaking only of mine. I've talked with enough pastoral colleagues to realize that this has become quite widespread. So when we're at our best as Adventists in both the healthcare setting and in the church setting, we've cared for others, even at cost to ourselves. We've sacrificed. I'll tell you, here at Loma Linda, and the same has been true at every healthcare center that you represent, I have been brought to tears at times with what has happened in the context of our hospitals. To hear the stories many times from the people actually involved, at what cost has come to them personally, emotionally, at times in terms of their own health, in order to care for others during this pandemic, it has been powerfully moving. At our best, we've respected those with whom we differ, caring for their liberty as well as ours. We've recognized that this issue of religious liberty doesn't just apply to some who may worship on a different way or may see some perspectives on life differently, but that we have to stand with and for others with whom we may differ. And finally, at our best, we have grown toward maturity in Christ as we await the parousia, that we've recognized that we live in a real world, that we inhabit a place that Jesus said we are to occupy until he comes. And we've gone about the business of caring for our communities, of caring for the other, of caring for the least of these, as part of what it means to grow toward maturity in Christ. I think those represent some of the things we have done when we're at our best. But we're not always at our best. And I think this pandemic has kind of underlined some of that. At our unhealthiest, we have dismissed the threat that COVID presents to many. We've dismissed it, and I've heard all kinds of statements made about it, sometimes in the most shocking ways, sometimes in ways that are more subtle, but maybe just as real. This is nothing. It's no big deal. This will pass. It's been made way too much of. And we just kind of dismissed that threat and what that may mean to people. We've demanded our rights, even at threat to others. So as this pandemic got underway, we here at the church were in deep consultation with our leaders on the other side of the sidewalk, our LLUH leaders. In fact, some have asked me, and I'll tell you that when we are making decisions as a church how to proceed, we are attentive to three different publics. And you may disagree with this, but I'll just tell you where my priorities are. My first question is, how do we stay in step with LLUH? Our partners, our scientists, our healthcare leaders who understand this far better than we do. Secondly, how do we stay in step with the sisterhood of churches that are Seventh-day Adventist in this general area? And finally, what is the county and what is the government saying? And that has come up for great criticism in many different settings. And people have said in the most ungenerous language what their opinion is about doing that very thing and how we need to do it differently. We have a right to this, and it's been kind of disturbing. And then finally, we've interpreted or eisegeted scripture to the extent of equating the mark of the beast with the COVID vaccine. I've listened to this with sometimes fascination and sometimes horror. It's the first time I've realized that I can get the mark of the beast by accident. So I've questioned throughout this entire process, what does it mean to live the ethical standard of Jesus? And what is the ethical standard of Jesus for healthcare, for the church, for the academy? What is that? I think it has not been better stated than in these words, and I've drawn them from Mark's gospel, although they are also present in Matthew's gospel. One of the teachers of the law came and heard them debating. Noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer, he asked him, "Of all the commandments, which is the most important?" "The most important one," answered Jesus, "is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these." "Well said, teacher," the man replied. "You are right in saying that God is one and there is no other but him. To love him with all your heart, with all your understanding, with all your strength, and to love your neighbors as yourself is more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices." When Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, "You're not far from the kingdom of God." And from then on, no one dared ask him any more questions. So what would that look like today? What does that look like today, particularly during this time of COVID pandemic? Well, some have seen these two, love for God and love for others, in conflict in a time of COVID. That we can't maintain both of these in proper perspective, that they actually stand against each other. To love, read, obey God, means we don't obey the government or worry about the fears of or threat to others. Our administrative pastor here at Loma Linda is Joey O. And Pastor Joey has led us in terms of our response, how we respond and what that means for the guidelines that we take. And I really appreciated as he articulated what our goals overall would be during this time. He said, our goals are really twofold. One is for people to be safe. And then two, insofar as we can, for people to feel safe. So it's a recognition that we're trying to address people at their point of deepest need. And the conviction is we can both love God and love others during a time of COVID. So to close off, it leaves me with three questions that others will have to weigh in on. I've worked with these myself, but I would certainly be curious to hear the answers of others. What does it mean to love God in a time of COVID? How do we express that? How does it play itself out? What does it look like pragmatically and practically? Second, what are the boundaries of liberty / religious liberty in the face of caring for our neighbor? What does that mean? What does that mean in terms of masks? What does that mean in terms of distancing? What does that mean in terms of gathering? What does it actually mean? For some, those are questions that are obvious, but they're questions that we face almost every day here on this campus. And finally, how does one love, read, dialogue with those absorbed with conspiracy theories? They're very real. I would like to say that they're the stuff of fantasy, but I've faced them too many times in recent months to think that they're not real in people's hearts and lives. So I think it all comes down to me to asking the question, in the ethical standard of Jesus, love for God and love for others, how is that lived out in a divided, polarized time like this? Thank you.
Wow. Thank you, Pastor Randy. That was very well spoken. I'm looking at the time and I want to make sure that I give time to our next speaker, and then we will go from there. So Dr. Brower, time is yours. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Francisco. Appreciate your earlier introduction. It was very generous, and also your leadership in bringing this panel together. Also, Dr. Winslow, for persisting in the need to have this conversation. I've learned in these few years of having the pleasure of working with you that we do well to catch the visions that you cast. So thank you for this opportunity. I do want to acknowledge also, you heard from Dr. Peter Landless from the General Conference yesterday, and also share with you the support of the North American Divisions Administration in the vital work and conversations that the consortium has been championing. And I believe Elder Ken Denslow is with us today. He is a special assistant to the president in the North American division, and he could express that much more eloquently than I. So Ken, I hope I did some amount of justice. I really want to thank Dr. Roberts also for those three very stirring questions that you ended with. Those are questions that we are also wrestling with at the North American division level. And I'm not necessarily going to address those, but I just want to thank you for bringing those up in this current context. And Dr. Brian, I want to recognize your presentation too, because it really helped me understand the importance of what our core values do and how they do and can inform us at every step. So thank you for bringing that up. I actually want to share with you today some of my core values that I bring to the Health Ministries Department at the North American Division, because these do inform how I process projects here at the department. And I will admit that these haven't been codified in any way, but just as a starting point for helping us to have conversations together, because we really do at the North American Division, we want to enter into conversation with each of you and the expertise and roles that you carry. So the first core value that I practice is the belief that when rightly understood, the Bible and science actually do agree. In fact, Ellen White, one of our pioneers and founders of the Adventist Church, makes several statements to that effect. And here is one from the book Christ Triumphant. She says, "Rightly understood, science and the written word agree, and each sheds light on the other. Together, and I emphasize that word, together they lead us to God by teaching us something of the wise and beneficent laws through which he works. I think that's just a powerful, powerful summary of how it is really important that the church and the scientific community really should and could work hand in hand. So one of the core activities of my department to reflect this is to bridge the gap between biblical and scientific understanding. There is a presentation I share titled Science or Fiction, where I look at how biblical and scientific understanding are not mutually exclusive. But as the quote we just read says, it is complementary. Now, this presentation is geared to an audience who may be more skeptical towards science, but who do believe strongly in the health ministry of the Adventist Church. So yes, it is true that some people need help in understanding that the two can walk side by side. And so I do share quotes from Ellen White, because that is the language that this group often understands and goes to. But I also share the important scientific and public health principles, such as the research process and how we determine cause and effect. Other things that we do is to create opportunities for our health professionals to be involved in ministry at the local church level, at various levels of the church organization, because we want to bring their expertise, their knowledge, their experience, and bring it into the understanding of the church, the local church body, the local church members as well. A second core value that I have, that I hold dear, is the diversity and unity that are needed in work that we do. The North American Division serves a very diverse population, not only from racial or ethnic standpoint, but also in beliefs and practices. And yes, even within church members of any given denomination, there is diversity. So I take the public health approach that we need to speak to individuals in the language that they understand, as I mentioned already. What results then is often the need for multiple ways and multiple methods to reach individuals where they are in order to meet their needs. So I really do believe that there is room for all of us if we come to the table with respect and recognition that our different approaches meet the needs of different groups, remembering that there is also much that we share and much that we do agree on. So rather than taking a one-size-fits-all approach, I do promote a collaborative approach that respects diversity of viewpoints. I like to use the example of the books of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, which together give us a more holistic view of the Gospels. And likewise in ministry, the whole, I believe, is greater than even the sum of its parts. And the third core value that I like to practice in my role is informed decision making, using research to back up and inform our decisions, including when it comes to production of health resources, what we share, what we make available to our churches. Research is a core part of who I am, having worked in public health research for a number of years. So I do bring this to the table in health ministries. And we've heard the quote several times during this consortium, nothing about me without me. And Carla shared beautifully in other words, talk to me. And I believe this is one of the things that research does, is that it creates a process for conversations with the people who we want to help, the people who we want to talk with, to walk with on this journey. So since we are talking about bioethics, I actually did a very quick online survey on the topic of bioethics and the church. Now, I'll share as a disclaimer, this is simply a pulse survey. It did not pass the rigorous tests of scientific process, which I would have preferred to have done, but given the time limitations, I really just wanted to get an idea of what do people of faith think about bioethics. So I am going to switch to share my screen here and just share with you very briefly some of the results from that survey. And let me get that up here. And okay, do you see that on your screens? Bioethics and the Church. I see some heads nodding. Great. So again, this is just a very quick online survey that I did over the past, actually the past 2 or 3 days. I posted it online on Facebook. So this is talking about my own personal network on Facebook. And I did receive 51 responses as of this morning. So who are these respondents? 8 of them said that they were employed by the church. 15 were healthcare professionals or retired professionals. 8 were employed by healthcare organizations. 4 were church administrators, and then 14 were a variety of others. And they were able to select more than one option here, so we do have some overlap. A little bit more about this group of individuals, 51 responses again. The majority of them are members of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. We only had one other person, I believe, who is a Christian of another denomination. So again, this is important to consider. We're looking at a very select group of respondees here. The majority, 90%, are from the United States and a few from a few other countries across the world. So I asked the question, do you feel that you know enough about bioethics? And 3/4 of them said that they do not know enough about bioethics. The next question I asked is, do you think the average Christian knows enough about bioethics? And kind of turning in their peers, 96% said no, my peers do not know enough, although 25% of them think that they themselves know enough. So that's very interesting. Also asked the question, should Christians as individuals be involved in conversations on bioethical issues? And I think this is quite astounding that nearly 90% of them believe that Christians should individually be active when it comes to bioethical issues. When we connect that to how many of them actually know enough, then this is quite an interesting quandary that we're finding ourselves in. I also asked the question, should leadership levels of denominations be active? And a little bit fewer, 72% said that yes, leaders of our churches should also be involved in bioethical questions. So another question, who do you think is best qualified to discuss bioethical issues with Christians? Okay, that's the qualifier. And nearly 33% said their pastor or chaplain. And I think that's very interesting. They feel that their pastor or chaplain is the best qualified to speak on this issue. 30% said that a trained educator at a hospital, 28% said their physician or healthcare provider. So interesting comparison between our clergy and our healthcare providers. And a few of them responded church administrators or family members. So I asked a number of other questions as well, but we don't have time to look at those, but I do want to share this as well. Where do you get information of most of your information about bioethical issues? And quite a variety of responses. They could type in their answers here. We see that there are some health professionals who responded. They get their resources from their professional organizations and journals, from books that they read. Online research showed up quite often, and I was surprised to see TikTok on here. I'll be quite honest. I did not know that TikTok has a is a quote unquote reliable source for bioethical issues. But they are Googling these topics. They are looking on YouTube to learn about this. Some of them have taken classes. Some of them have family members that they can go to, documentaries. A few were very, very adamant that it was the Bible alone, or the Bible first, at least, and also Ellen White writings. Some are looking at research publications, conversations. So that's a vague statement, but conversations with whom would be interesting. And then again, some who are involved in this from a professional level, and so work trainings. So what this tells me, again, this very quick, unsophisticated pulse survey, it tells me that there is a sphere of conversations happening on bioethics issues, particularly online, that maybe we need to be a part of. I have no doubt that many of our health institutions are present online, but I wonder about the value of a collaborative educational approach as well, because they want to be active. They want to be a voice on these issues. So members of the Adventist Church are interested in topics of bioethics. They want to know more, and they want to be good stewards of society. So perhaps what we see here is an opportunity. And I will end there. Thank you.
Wow, thank you for that pulse survey. I know when we had met prior to the conference, that was one of the things that I was looking forward to, because I think you're absolutely right. Just looking at our three speakers today, we have at a system level, and also at Pastor Randy Roberts at his level, with being at Loma Linda University Health, our flagship hospital, and then also you as part of the North American division. I think there is, as you said, some more collaborative educational support and conversations that we can be a part of and participate in. I think that's something that's evident in what you shared for us. So thank you for that. I'm looking at the time, Dr. Winslow. We have. I think I don't want to brag about it, but it seems like we have some time to have for questions and conversation. I do like the idea, Randy, for questions that you actually presented. But I want to just before we open up maybe some of those questions and some questions that some of you have, I'm looking through the chat at the same time. I want to ask a question, and this is obviously for any one of you three, but for any of our listeners, because this pandemic has truly, I think it has, as many of you have said in so many words, it has caused us to look back at those red books, if we put it in that language, to really refocus and reshift and connect why we exist and why we do what we do. But one of the things that has come up, at least in our local market with Adventist Health, and I'm sure it has with you, is the moral distress and burnout that has happened in the last 12 to 16 months. Let's be honest, maybe even before the pandemic came, there were already people burnt out in the areas that they worked at. But Randy, you had mentioned something in a previous conversation, as you shared with us, the sidewalk and looking at both spectrums of the sidewalk. But you actually have been a part on the ground level as the VP for the hospital side of things, as it relates to providing the physical, the emotional, the psychological support for our healthcare providers. In terms of resilience, how are we as a church, and I'll even go as far as saying as a healthcare system, reconnecting our communities to remain passionate about the sacred work that we have been assigned as it relates to our Adventist faith? How have you seen the need? And I think you explained some of that. How have you seen that need, and how have you been able to play a part of that as someone who's personally provided that support for our healthcare system?
Thank you, Francisco. The first thing I would say is that I hope one of my colleagues who's on the screen here will weigh in, and that's Kathy McMillan. Kathy McMillan is the employee spiritual care coordinator for the medical center here in Loma Linda. and does nothing short of amazing work in those very areas you're talking about. So let me say just a couple of things. First of all, one of the things that Kathy does is she will stand outside of our hospital at shift change time, morning and evening, at different points in time throughout the week, and just has a sign that says, "I'll pray with you." People stop, and Kathy prays with them, and they share the most amazing stories of burnout, of loss, of grief, of spiritual care that they need. And I've just been impressed and touched each time I've heard Kathy talk about that, because people really are struggling with that. So that's one thing I would say. I really think that a second reality that is crucially important is staying deeply connected to mission. I think I'll speak from a personal sense. The times I am most prone to burnout are the times that I lose contact with the underlying why of what I'm doing. When I can only see all these whats, and there's a list, a longer list than I can get to of whats, it's easy to be overwhelmed with it. But if I can stay rooted to the why underneath it, that is extremely helpful. And I think that's why that passage that I read from Jesus is so fundamentally important. It keeps me connected to the why. I'm here as an expression of my love for God and as an expression of my love for others. And that's enormously helpful. So those are a couple of things I would say initially. I don't know if, I can't see all the screen, so I think Kathy is still here. She was here earlier, but if she is, I'd love to hear what Kathy might have to say about your question, because I think it's an excellent question.
I'm eager to read the article that Alex just posted, because it seems to be something that we're struggling with so much. And all I did was read the title, and I think it's true, because I have talked with nurses, physicians, others who just say, "I'm ready to be done." There is something that's so disheartening about, you know, coming in and in the middle of the pandemic and having working on our COVID ICU, the one that has had COVID patients up until this week. We finally had a day where none of our ICUs had a COVID patient. But then having family members calling in and literally yelling at them over the phone, telling them that they are making this up and killing their loved ones. And, you know, that has been a huge challenge. So I think we have to just work little bits at a time wherever we can to try and provide opportunities. Another thing that's gone very, very well for us through this time is our Schwartz rounds. Being able to do that on Zoom has given us a platform where we've had literally hundreds of people that have participated, and that's been really wonderful.
Thank you, Kathy, for speaking to that. It's definitely something I know that all of us are facing with individuals who have kind of hit that plateau, being burned out. What I'll do is share my screen here. I don't know, Alex, if you wanted to respond at all, if any, to that as well, specifically perhaps the mission that is grounded with some of the things that you have been doing through the Adventist Health System. But there's some things recently that you have been doing in regards to connecting system-wide each of the local markets with what are some of the things and stories that we're hearing that are happening in the midst of this pandemic. Maybe you can speak to just what are one of those things that resonates deeply with you in your position as chief of our mission, as you're steering us forward and keeping us aligned with why as a company we so strongly feel about our mission and connecting that with how we actually do healthcare across the system.
Yeah, just two quick things. One is, I think trying to facilitate as much storytelling as possible. The telling of story, not only inside one locality, but the telling of story across the enterprise, I think is so important. And I'm not talking about the stories that I tell. I'm talking about providing environments where clinicians can tell stories to one another, happy stories, sad stories, stories of meaning and purpose. I think there's real healing in that. So I think that's one, which is not a fancy, sexy idea, right? But it's just, how do we do the best job we possibly can to create a storytelling culture where there's time to tell those stories? So I think that's, and that was our approach at our mission summit last week. For those of you that had opportunity to see it, was to try to provide a forum for that storytelling. And the second, I'll just underscore something that Randy said, and that's, I do think the why question is critical. And I think, I know we've all been exposed to Balboni's book and research, but there, one little piece of that that I keep coming back to is there's a hint of, is it possible, and this was pre-pandemic, but their question, is it possible that doctors are burning out, not because of EMRs, not because of regulations, not because they're, you know, having to see 30 patients when they like to see 15 a day. Is it possible that it's a disconnection from the why question? Is it possible that we can plow through some pretty tough stuff if we understand a connection to deeper meaning? And so, Francisco, I guess those two are front and center. And I think, again, and I would just say lastly, Kathy referenced the article I posted. I think it's the ridicule that such a high percentage of our population have heaped on science and heaped on our clinicians that is the extra gear beyond all the hours, beyond all the other factors of fatigue. I think we're in a different place, to be honest. I think we're in a different place than we were 2 years ago with the way that the people that we're caring for are treated and viewed. I believe that. And I think that we've got some, you know, I know I'm a pastor, so you'll forgive me, Francisco. I'm going to keep defaulting. I'm a pastor at heart, but I think we've got some serious pastoral work to do for these folks, because the profession is not viewed in the same limelight. If doctors were once gods, and my father's a physician, so I know what I'm talking about. If doctors were once viewed as gods, now they're viewed as dogs. I think there's some real challenges there. So I'll be quiet. That would be my response to your question, Francisco.
Thank you, Alex, for that spot on. I'm trying to multitask and look at some of the chat, at some of the comments that are coming through. And I do want to share my screen just here, just so that I can have those questions that Randy so wonderfully shared with us. Let me give this attempt and see if I can get this. Oh, there it is. Can you guys see my screen? Can you see that? Yeah. So maybe we can, I see we're have about 15 minutes left, Dr. Winslow, but I do want to open this up to some questions for anyone here if they want to take a crack at any of these. Maybe I can just begin by just saying this. I think our local market here at Adventist Health and Rideout really have been grappling with, you know, these last 15 months and how do we love in a time like this when our mission is living God's love by inspiring health, wholeness, and hope? What does it mean to step into that space, as you put it, where we can actually let our associates know that that they are cared for at a time when we're short staff? I think one of the things that we've been trying to do through our governance committees and patient experience committees and different councils is trying to be intentional about what is being said at a ground level. And I think for us, that has helped us to really realize how are they feeling. And so there's a couple of things that we do with rounding that have enabled those times for story to be shared, whether it's rounding on the floor or through being a part of some of the staff meetings. And so I think that's an ongoing challenge for us to really get to the ground of what that means to love in a time that's difficult to us. But I think it's a new chapter for us to say, this needs to be a new normal for us, that we are going to be intentional about doing that. And it's something that we all can do together. Is there any other questions? I'm looking.
I see one here, Francisco, from Mark Carr to Dr. Brower, about the role of the NAD in engaging us in conversations. I don't know, Angeline, if you can see that question and if you want to address that.
Yes, absolutely. I was actually in the process of typing my response, but happy to respond verbally as well. There certainly are opportunities. I'd like to point out Carlisle, my new and good friend, shared this during his presentation. We have actually engaged with our healthcare systems in conversations about COVID-19 and the vaccine specifically. Carlisle is serving as one of the representatives from healthcare to be part of a task force that is aimed at educating our membership. And actually we are next Saturday, not this coming Saturday, but the May 15th, we are having an online symposium that is actually reaching out to all Christians, not just Seventh-day Adventist Christians, because we know that there are many from a evangelical background that we've heard from research who tend to be more vaccine hesitant. So we are having those conversations and we are engaging with our healthcare organizations. This entire process began with a conversation with our healthcare organizations even earlier, asking about the need to engage in this. You heard from Dr. Landless again from the General Conference about their process of how they come up with statements and how they publish that. I think we have had actually incredible involvement. I know, Dr. Roberts, you serve on writing committees for the North American Division and have been an incredible asset when documents are put together from the North American Division. So there are certainly opportunities. Now, I will say that any kind of official statements, documents, these come from the executive secretary's office. So health ministries may or may not be involved, but certainly there's an opportunity and an avenue for reaching out to them and making a plea for bringing conversations to the forefront. Now, if we're talking about educating churches at a local level, since the pandemic started, we have been having webinars that we've had fairly good attendance from our church members. So that is a process of education that we've been doing, and we bring on health professionals. We've talked about health disparities. We've talked about trauma. We've talked about some of these issues. So there are opportunities that way as well. So that's a start. There are many other conversations that we could certainly have as to how to do even more together. I hope that's a good start.
Thank you, Dr. Brower. I'm seeing a question here from Zach. Can the NAD initiative link be shared here? Is that something you can share for us here?
So I will, the program is being aired on Hope Channel. This will be from 4 to 6:30 p.m. Eastern time zone. So Hope Channel is airing it, and it will also be live streamed on the NAD Facebook page. So I can look for that link and put it in here. I will share just a little bit of insider news. We have our production team working with the Loma Linda University Church. Dr. Roberts, thank you so much. They are filming some of the segments today. So we're very thankful for the collaboration that we have with our entire division in bringing this together. But yes, I will at least get that Facebook link in the chat in a moment.
Thank you for that. Am I missing any other questions, Dr. Winslow? I'm still kind of...
No, I think there's been a rich exchange of ideas and comments in the chat. I would remind all of you that we've changed the rules here such that you can unmute yourself if you choose, and you can just speak up if you have a comment or a question you would like to ask. Most of the time when I've been teaching over the years, if we end early, my students never complain. So we'll just do that. But I did want to ask Alex Bryan a question. If I understood what you're saying about your program to educate leaders, executives in your system, where do you find the time to do that? I'm just imagining the pushback to sometimes the kind of work that we do has been referred to by some I've met as the soft stuff. You know, you have to do, we have to devote our time to the hard stuff, and the soft stuff can usually be much more optional. How do you get buy-in for that? And I think you said you're fairly assertive about insisting on that. How have you done that without, I haven't had to update your resume, so I assume that you're still employed there. Tell us how that's done.
Well, now that you mention it, I'm just wondering where I could send that resume.
Well, with your new degree in bioethics, we may have a deal for you.
I'll say a couple things about that. And of course, I've got Meredith and Steve here who know because they're enrolled in the experience as executives. So one, this came from the board. So that's number one. The board said we need to value this. Two, I think COVID provided an advantage for us in that everybody can jump on more quickly through this environment, which in a system that's far flung would have been more challenging early on. We asked for roughly an hour a month. Okay, so that's the parameter. Is there pushback, Jerry? Sure. Am I fully aware that there's executives who probably go, man, this is one more hour in my day? Of course. And I totally respect that because I know what that feels like. But my hope is that through quality and through some consistency and habit, that devoting 1 hour in a 200 hour, or you know, name the time, a 200 hour month, that will start to feel reasonable. And once post-COVID, we'll have an annual retreat of sorts that will be a part of this. And of course, all of you know, I mean, the Catholic Health Association has been doing these kinds of things for a long time. So, and we're not just copying what they have done, but I've spent a lot of time talking with Dearman Rooney, who leads their work and understanding their pitfalls, what's gone well, what hasn't. We're gonna give it a go, man. I hope 5 years ago I can say that this stuck, you know, but this is the first attempt in our company for a systematic formation process where ethics is one quarter of that curriculum. And so you're asking all the right questions. I mean, I think it's challenging because of the time commitment, but we're trying to find the sweet spot. And I think, you know, we've got deeply missional leaders like Meredith Jobe, like Steve Herber, who care about these things. And so I feel like I have allies to try to get us in the right place.
Hey, Alex, if I were mean spirited, I'd just say, well, that 1 hour nap time. No, but it is important. And I think it's been an important part of the time. And then the only thing I'd add, Alex, is go Dodgers. Anyway.
Yeah, another unrepentant sinner. But Jerry, let me just say this. I'll make my final appeal. If we're not intentional about forming the hearts and minds of the people that are calling the shots, then we have to rely on Randy on Sabbath morning. And I'm not being flip in saying that. Then it defaults to, or how can Dr. Bauer rescue us through her? Like, there has to be some intention inside our companies. There has to be some intentional formation, or I think that we're not going to achieve what we need to achieve. And so I'll just say that. So I'm prayerful and hopeful that this will gain traction.
I think Jim Walters wants to comment on that.
Alex, I want to commend you and what you're doing. And and you're going against the stream in Adventist thought, because we, unlike the Catholics, don't have a rich tradition that goes back centuries of moral reflection. And I fear that too many of us Adventists, when we get educated and sophisticated, we're no longer religious fundamentalists, but we can fill that vacuum with other types of fundamentalism. I mean, it may be the bottom line for your executives. It might just be excellent health care in a secular sense. And many of us aren't educated to realize the point that you're driving home to us today, and that is the importance of recognizing that every one of us works from some sort of presuppositions about existence. And for us to assume that just because these are good civil, moral people, many of them Adventist, that they have put things together and that they are making a connection between the way that money is invested, the way that decisions are made in regard to healthcare, that is tied to some foundational thinking. I mean, you are to be commended for helping us to become more sophisticated so that our thought life keeps up with our business and medical expertise. Thank you.
You know, this is a perfect segue, I think, for the next session that we'll be having with Peter Bath and Mark Carr. They'll be taking us along this same pathway and adding to what we've been talking about. I think we're finally getting to the flavor we would have in a meeting if we were all together. The hands would be flying up and the comments would be coming forward. But we're down to our last couple of minutes. Final words from any of the three speakers or from you, Francisco?
Randy? Yes, I'd like to call attention in the chat to Carl Rickett's comment. I didn't realize earlier Carl was on, but he's put in what I think is a really solid, strong comment about what it means to love in a time of COVID. So just to call attention to that, it's well stated.
I see it here. Well, I saw a sign in one of our offices. Behind every mask is the face of a person who cares. And kind of helped frame the issue a bit for me. Well, let me thank Francisco. Thank you, Francisco, for convening this. It's an interesting challenge to try to watch all of these things happen on the screen at the same time, and you've done it with grace. So, and thanks to our three speakers. We're going to take about a 15-minute break now. And then we will have our final session, and we'll make a few plans for next year. We have secured a date and a place, and I want to share that with you as we wrap up today. But let's take a 15-minute break now, and we'll come back at a quarter to the hour. Be hosted at this hour by Mark Stoddard. Dr. Stoddard is the Vice President for Ministry Formation and Workplace Spirituality. I was talking with Mark the other day about that title and thinking that's a very comprehensive and I think in many ways enviable title. So thank you, Dr. Stoddard, Mark, for leading out this time, and please introduce our speakers.
Thank you very much, Jerry. Good afternoon to some, good morning still to a few others, and it is good to be with you coming in from the mountain state of Denver, Colorado, and I'm really, really excited to be participating in this conference, and in particular to introduce this subject or the topic that we're going to spend the next few minutes talking about. I think it was Mardian Blair who once said, if you're going to run a French restaurant, you need a French chef. Actually, multiple French chefs. And then he went on to say, you can't run a Seventh-day Adventist Christian hospital without people who have bought into that philosophy at the top and certainly at all levels below. Be the people who have bought into the Christian philosophy. And then I was excited to hear Alex Bryan this morning say that in order for ministry and mission to be effective, we need to have a powerful connection to the why we do what we do. And that's where I believe formation plays a significant role, something that has been resisted to a large degree across Adventist health systems for some time. And I just wanted to, let me just share a quick slide with you as I introduce why I think this is going to be good for us to do. Okay. All right. The truth is that we have all been formed. We've all experienced formation at one point or another in our lives. If you've ever played baseball, and you've been coached by a dad or a coach, you've experienced formation. If you have been taught, you have experienced formation. If you've been to medical school, you've experienced formation. If you've experienced Sabbath school or Pathfinders, you have experienced formation. The whole idea behind formation is being formed into what you need to be in order to be fully effective in what you will do. And so I'm excited to introduce our two presenters today. And first I wanna introduce Peter Bath, who is a mentor and friend. Most of you, if not all of you, have experienced Peter in one venue or another. Peter is really big on building community. It's been a consistent theme throughout his life. He has participated in congregational work as a pastor. He's been an educator. He's been an administrator. He loves to network with communities and bring resources in ways that impact the lives of communities. And his Bible verse that one of the Bible verses that drives his life is that in Jeremiah 29, verse 7. We love to go to verse 11. But Peter points out that what drives him is the mandate to seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. He and Kathy, his wife, have been married for 44 years. They reside in Dayton, Ohio, along with their golden retriever. Their interests include sailing, skiing, scuba diving, music, camping, beekeeping. I found that one quite interesting because I didn't know that about you, Peter. And the family includes three daughters, two sons-in-law, three grandsons, and a granddaughter. And family is found residing and working in Ohio, Washington, D.C., and London, England. And if that door behind Peter was open, there would be a significant possibility of a red-haired grandson coming in to sit on granddad's lap. It's been a frequent occurrence in our Zoom calls. Our other contributor this morning is Mark Carr. And Mark joined the church in his early 20s, is a graduate of Walla Walla College and Andrews University. He worked as a pastor and the conference youth director in Alaska before returning to education. He received a PhD in religious ethics from the University of Virginia. And then he taught at Loma Linda University, as mentioned earlier, in Kettering College for about 20 years. When the opportunity to return to his home in Alaska came up, he joined the Providence Health System as regional director for ethics back in 2015. In addition to his work, he enjoys being a pilot, a commercial fisherman, and has recently become enamored with his electric fat tire bicycle. So, Wendy, can you really call it a bicycle if it's powered? I don't know. So, again, Jerry, thank you very much for the opportunity to share, and thank you for your mentorship and support over the years. And I'm going to hand over now to my two esteemed colleagues and have them lead us in this conversation.
Peter, lead the way.
All right. Thank you. Let's see, getting this set up. There we go. So yeah, thanks very much, Mark. It's been a joy working with Mark Squared. Two Marks is always better than one, and it's just a joy to be with you. Thank you, Jerry, for being persistent, for being the hair shirt that nudges us forward as we have done. We've worked together for so many years. It's a joy and will continue to be so. And to look at the panoply of pictures, I feel like I'm watching Romper Room. Some of you remember what that was, but to see so many of you and to be able to call out, thank you for that. My portion of this in looking at formation is going to take the hive, interestingly, a Mark Stoddard, the beehive in healthcare, and looking at leadership, ethics, and culture. Don't get too lost in the metaphors. I hope to land the bee, if you will, at the end. And we'll move this along. Let's see if I can get this set up. Are you all able to see the screen? Okay, good. All right. So in the book of Job, there's a remarkable prayer. Elihu prays, teach me to see what I still don't see. Wise is the one who knows what they don't know. And the questions we're going to look at today are basic formation, institutional or individual or both. What is your style or focus of choice? Governance and organizational culture, new wine and old wineskins. And then on seeing anew, we're going to look through bees' eyes and see how we might apply lessons of the hive to healthcare. So going back to the very beginning, we're all formed. Mark, your metaphor of the clayer and the potter, very true. Two basic schools, moral duty formation or spiritual virtue formation. Interestingly enough, we were talking about burnout, and I think Alec and Mark Carr were referencing the burnout of healthcare and what's going on in focus when our moral duty formation is the attempt to grow or fix ourselves, trying to be good and pleasing to God, be that the CEO, CMS, or whatever might be the one we're trying to appease. The temptation is to wrestle against the structure that we're in the midst of and fight that unending fight. I'm giving you a lot of notes here that you can pick up later on as you download this. But the bottom part of this is that our first thought is, I'll do better, I'll try harder. And it becomes a thing where we make our plan and invite Jesus to join us. How many board meetings, how many planning meetings have I been in where perfunctory prayer is offered, hoping to sanctify and sanitize that which we do, all the while knowing full well nobody's going to change squat. We just want a good luck charm. That's the moral duty. The spiritual virtue formation is that of growing through the Holy Spirit, being formed in Christ's likeness. I so have appreciated, Mark Carr, your prolific chat comments that you bring. You are amazing. I admire both your ability to think and your ability to type at the same time. I always get them mixed up. But the whole idea that we cannot fix ourselves, spiritual formation is relational as opposed to behavioral under the moral duty. Now you sit back and think of how our denomination is focused. We are moral duty people. That's how we're formed. That's how we grew up. Mark, you and I both came into the church later in life. but I've seen it pastorally, I've seen it educationally, and we are much more moral duty focused than we are. Look what the hospital does when the union president or the conference president or the GC president is coming for a visit. I remember when we had Elder Falkenberg come to visit us here in the midst of his big dust up about trying to control healthcare. There wasn't a coffee pot to be found. They were all in the staff cupboards hiding away. That sense of moral, we got to polish the apple to look right. Moral duty, we struggle against, as Paul struggles at, as opposed to that virtual spiritual formation where we can rest with the beloved. We can allow the Lord to speak to us. Sister Teresa, Mother Teresa said that, this is Teresa of Avila, we need to learn to sit with our weeds and listen to them. And we can't. We've got the Roundup out before we can even see a weed. And so spiritual formation is about that. Now, three primary approach to ethics: virtue ethics, which is the spiritual dimension, duty ethics, which is the moral, or utilitarian ethics. Under the virtue, who ought I to be? What is my purpose or function? How do I fulfill that? And it becomes a character, an innate sense of who I am. Duty ethics, set the person aside, and it's about what ought I to do? How do I understand and adhere and argue moral absolutes? And what are the rules and resulting obligations? Utilitarian ethics tends to be much more, if you will, political in some way. What brings happiness to the greatest number of people? What maximizes pleasure instead of pain? What are the outcomes and consequences that has its place? But I think the two that I want to focus on are virtue and duty. And the fundamental question I want to ask you, which of these two formed you growing up? Which of these two continues to form you? In fact, which of these two has formed your peers? Which of these two have formed your executive leaders? Which of these two would characterize the essence of your organization? Because once we've understanding from whence we have come, we can then begin to lay the axe against the tree that needs to be dealt with. Well, let's not use the axe cutting down a tree metaphor. Let's look about the idea of planting seeds and nurturing a garden that people will want to participate in. I think that chopping down tree comes from my duty formation myself. So teach me to see what I still don't see. Are we asking the right questions? Is the focus only on leaders, or ought this to include systems as well? Are we getting lucky when we get a good set of executive leaders and they carry the ball for a while, only to walk away from, have the institution walk away from because a new set of people have come in? Whose vision, whose mission do we carry? Does the institution have its vision and mission with its local community, or is it dependent upon that who is now at the helm telling us where to go and what to do? I remember interviewing with one of the large congregations in our denomination back in the 80s, and they said, tell us your vision, your vision for ministry. And I said, well, I think my vision, I'll share with you eventually, but I want to hear what yours is. Because if you're shopping for a pastor who's got a vision, I'm the wrong guy. If you don't have a vision of who you're to be, we've got much more work to do than filling a pulpit with good preaching. I think we fall into the same type of thing in our selection of leaders. We lack the context to say, this is where we're going. We need you to help us move there. We tend to look and shop for vision and direction. So, the focus only on leaders, or should there be a systemic way of creating that culture? Systems of individual formation and corporate governance are fundamental. You know, your ethics committees operating the same charter with continuing education and reporting. Do you have that concept that Alex spoke of, where every conversation is one where you bring forth the principles of mission and Christian identity? I'd love to sit in on the conversations about compensation. I facilitated a great symposium in Florida many, many years ago where we had all the health systems come together and we were talking about unions. And what do we do with the unionization and particularly the prolific part in California? But I raised the idea of compensation. I said, we can talk about unions now, but you're going to have to talk about compensation where CEO's salary is 500-600 times that of an average entry-level worker. Is there a place where that ethical question can be raised? So has the culture of healthcare been surrendered? Or is it something that we as a group need to reclaim and to speak to? And I think that needs to be done in systematic ways of creating. Peter Senge has a great book. I hope you may have read it, The Five Disciplines of Creating Learning Organization, where you look at personal mastery, mental model, shared vision, team learning, and systems. Ways in which you create an organization in which dialogue and community is core. My question is there a lesson from the Hive, the ultimate learning organization that we might apply to healthcare? Most healthcare systems focus on cost, quality, and service. Profit-owned HCA examples, their ultimate outcome is return on investment. A community-based not-for-profit builds on those three core things, but adds to that their sense of community engagement and focus and that of larger humankind. What's going on? What do we need to do? And their concern is for the community, ergo their not-for-profit status because of their investment in them. What about faith-based healthcare? Faith-based not-for-profit ought to be focused on doing all to the glory of God, demonstrating, as so many of you have said, God's love. Well, we need systems to bring alignment to ensure that that comes forth. Here is the top of the pyramid and the very top of your org chart, okay? The org chart comes up here and there's the CEO. That's the one everybody focuses on. But my question is it really only the CEO's responsibility? And I want to unpack this a bit because within our health systems, you've got a president, you've got a board, an operating board. It may be a system board. It may be a board at each of the campuses, but they all fall under one organizational umbrella. But none of that happens without the voting membership. We used to call them constituencies. Constituencies that receive and appoint trustees, constituencies that vote the president of the system in and make that happen. So let's just take a look at this. The voting membership, which is by all of our bylaws required to be members of the Adventist Church and members within our situation, members of the executive committee of the union, a good representation so that we've got people in places that are going to really lead with integrity. They appoint the system president, they receive nominations and appoint trustees. Occasionally, they might get a report on mission or on ethos or things of that sort. Rarely do they sit down and have conversations for more than the hour or two that they're called to be together. The board has committees. Those committees have accountability, and it's their job to really ensure that the organization is performing as it promises to the community, more so as we've promised and covenanted with God. Our performance goals, not just patient SAD or EBITDA, but our performance goals on community benefit. What do we do there? Policy approval and the culture, a justice culture ethos that is there. These are the people that can help make that happen. The CEO certainly shapes culture and quality just by being around. Operational performance, engagement, and communication. But I want you to recognize that these two functions have far more import than I think we are inclined to give. We tend to have what American culture has stuck with is that we tend to see the only person in a hierarchy as the president. And sadly, that's been underscored by recent political leaders who have disdained their own cabinet, disdained everybody, and away they go. And so there's that challenge. So are we asking the right questions? And I list a series of questions here for you to look at about orientation for membership, board chair, and the role. You know, our board chairs, bless their hearts, it's a lot of work chairing a board. It's a lot of work chairing a board. Now, let me tell you, it's a lot of work, legal work, where you are accountable and you are liable should you not do that work well. And do we give them that opportunity? Is there regular education? Are they aware of industry that's going on? All the committees, do they know what's going on? And if they don't ask, if they don't know, do they ask? Some fundamental questions. Because if we're truly doing this to the glory of God, we need to have an environment and training that epitomizes that. Systems are important. And I worked most recently with AHS, not most recently, but here at Kettering, but trying to get this here at Kettering, but not meeting with much success. The idea of having what we had in the Adventist health system, the mission integrity of a peer review visit, the mission integrity of a Christian service plan annually, the mission development overview, looking at accountabilities for inclusivity and making sure that we're moving forward and measuring that. That is one system, to give an example. To do an ethics audit, we saw that coming from Ed Hernandez yesterday. Interestingly enough, I pulled a book out, I'll reference later. And in it was a phone message from Edwin Hernandez from 1997, January the 28th, please call me. We've been around for a long time and there's value. To look at an ethics audit to standardize what's going on. We have hospitals that lack the committees and things like that, that have really the issue of aligning. To do a mission risk audit to objectively assess integration, intentionality, and identity. And then to look at a trust audit. Is there trust? Are we able to talk openly without fear of reprisal? I've used this slide many times, that mission and vision and values give a spectrum of options. The choices that we make or we consider only exist in our head until we enact them. And then they become a behavior. When that behavior is repeated, you've got a culture. Carla mentioned that a culture is simply an accumulation of the actions of the people. And that's exactly what it is. That's what this says. But we have to really look at what that looks at. I've attached to the PowerPoint the competence use of mission leaders from Catholic Health Association, which is remarkable. They look at six dynamics: personal qualifications, leadership, theology, spirituality, ethics, and organizational management. Mark, I've told you many times how much I'm impressed with the work you do and the intentionality with which this moves forward. Now we're going to go to the beehive. Here are bees, and you can see them. In fact, Kathy and I, this is my wife, Kathy, my queen bee, if you will. She is holding the little wooden container that the queen bee came in that we had just released into the hive. And all these bees are covering her because they smell the pheromone of the queen and they follow the queen. Now I asked her, why are you laughing? She said, because they're buzzing and it's tickling me. Bees are unique. They have lenses. They don't see with eyeballs like we do, but they got like 7,000 compound lenses. They see in polarized light, like your polarized sunglasses, what you wear when you're skiing or golfing or out in the thing, they see ultraviolet light. This is how you and I see a dandelion on the left. That's how the bee sees it on the right. We talked about awe and the need for awe. Wow. So here's where the hive systems and culture comes in. This is the life cycle of a bee. It lasts only 6 weeks as it flies itself to death. But during the course of its life, it is accountable. The same bee will go from cleaning to nursery to wax building to nectar transfer to foraging, all at the behest of the queen. Clear communication that's done in the dark with pheromones. There's an accountability within the organization. The workers know the rate of the queen's egg laying, which is typically 2,000 eggs a day. If she slows down or if her pheromones begin to weaken in their strength, they will replace her. There's accountability and clarity here. And for those of us who are males, I want to remind you that every fall, the males are kicked out of the hive to conserve food over the winter, and the queen creates new males in the spring. I think we need more queens at the helm of our organizations. Mission, vision, and values. Choices, behavior, and culture. Here we have health systems in America. We've got over thousands and thousands of facilities, and facilities are becoming even more important than hospitals as we look at healthcare and delivery. We look at North America, we've got over 5,500 churches. How do we help a vision and systematic structures come about to sustain that vision and to move it forward? It's more than getting lucky and getting a good pastor. It's more than getting lucky and getting a good president or chief operating officer, or chief of staff. There are systems that bring those forth. Basic formation, what's your style? I want you to look at that. Governance of the organization, what's the organization? This is the book I was referencing, Reclaiming a Mission. When I was president of Kettering College in the 90s, I used this book to help remind academia, and I was working with all kinds of colleges, that our initial formation and our drift to who we are has been a challenge. I wonder if we need to do the same thing, not just for healthcare, but for our church, because I think quite frankly, our church is looking for a vision. What are we gonna be? How do we relate? And then seeing anew, seeing the hive and the healthcare. The hive looks after itself and makes sure it moves forward. It's really clear. We need that same clarity. Over to you, Mark Carr.
Excellent, thank you, Peter. I'm going to share my screen now. There we are. And to presentation mode. A couple things to keep in mind, I think, before we dig into some of the things I want to share, these are some of the background elements that have helped me understand, or at least frame things in my own mind. Spiritual care, ethical leadership, clinical ethics, they're all distinct. And I think sometimes, even though we have lots of overlap, in some ways, we need to protect and understand the distinctions between disciplines in ways that can serve us best. I was struck yesterday by the survey that noted at Advent Health that, what was it, something like 10 to 15% of all clinical ethics work was led by a clinical ethicist. According to national standards, that's abysmal. So some of these things need to be brought to light, I think. Adventist healthcare is both a ministry and a business. In studying for an article I wrote for Christian Bioethics Journal, I characterized three streams in Adventism: a ministerial branch, a healthcare branch, going back to Battle Creek, and then in the intervening years between then and now, a third and now completely ascendant subculture within Adventism is the business subculture. And case in point would be the development and power of the ASI group and similarly healthcare businesses. So it just strikes me we need to routinely remind ourselves that we are a ministry. Adventist healthcare is not owned or operated by the Adventist Church. I don't think our lay people or many of us even understand that. Now, I know there may be some possible exception that Loma Linda is owned and operated by the church, but all of the other healthcare systems, the behemoths in the town and country, are not owned technically by Adventism. Our connection with the church is not corporate or legal, it's relational, it's cooperative. And that has to form us somehow. the margin necessarily affects the mission. And those of us who have been around this bush a few times before often go off on tangents about which leads, the margin or the mission, the margin or the mission. Well, it may depend on what office you're sitting in, but I can assure you that the treasurers and the finance people who do their work are going to be focused primarily on the margin. And those in spiritual care and ethics will probably be focused primarily on the mission. Business leaders that we employ do not typically get educated or formed in mission by their educational institutions. Business subculture is a huge and pervasive subculture that is us. It is us, and we need to understand that. Mission, spiritual care, and ethics services are paid for by the margin of the corporation. We cannot bring money into our corporations. We can't bill for our services. An example of this was palliative care, and it didn't grow significantly until there was a medical specialty that could code or bill for its work. So I want to use now what's called an SBAR, Situation Background Assessment and Recommendation. It has to do with pushing ourselves forward toward a more purposeful effort of engaging in formation programs. So the situation is Adventist Healthcare in America is thriving, and our need for spiritually mature leaders who know Adventism well exceeds our ability to find them. Our business leaders need our help to recognize and embrace our healthcare as a ministry. And without sustained purposeful effort, our leaders will not understand that our mission drives the margin. And part of that is simply historical awareness. How did healthcare as a major branch of Adventism, going back to that three-branch system that I noted, how did the healthcare subculture in Adventism develop, grow, and become as significant as it is? The background, each of our corporations has existing leadership formation programs. And I would argue, I would assert that responsible stewardship of our resources compels us to find ways to work with each other to develop a centralized and efficient method of providing Adventist healthcare leadership formation. Alex Bryan noted in his talk just a few minutes ago that the Board of Adventist Health had recently committed themselves to this work. I noted in the margin, in the chat thread, that I'd been privileged to go through the formation program for Providence Health as the Regional Director of Ethics here in Alaska. A two-year program with 10 sessions where they flew, I think my cohort had 40 people in it. They flew us to a retreat center in the Seattle area from all over a 6-state western area, where we had 2.5-day retreats 10 times over a 2-year period. Imagine the expense of that. Imagine the commitment to that. And there's a rich, rich story behind the Ministry Leadership Center that was developed a long time ago that's no longer in existence, to my understanding, about how this kind of work was prompted. So we have lots to learn. And I think, again, stewardship would call us to learn from others, this best practices from other faith-based healthcare systems. Mm-hmm. I'm only really familiar with Adventist and Catholic systems, but by exponential measure, both in experience and expense, Catholic healthcare corporations have led the way. And I'm sure that we can glean best practices from them for our own needs. So here's my recommendation. I would want to be involved in helping cast the vision and find a cooperative, centrally located and administered a leadership formation program to extend the healing ministry of Jesus to the communities we serve. The vision would be to embrace our responsibility to develop our own leaders. How hard would that be? I think we're already there. Remind and recommit ourselves that we are a ministry, and that needs to be something that we remind ourselves of every day, it seems to me. Our goals will be to form leaders who know Adventism well and are committed to extending, like Mark Stoddard noted, that sense of buy-in. I still recall one meeting that I flew to back to Loma Linda, where we talked about some of these things, and a member in the audience, a Baptist person who had bought into the Adventist mission of Loma Linda, you know, all of herself was there. She wanted to know more, but she needed more in terms to help her to see herself as thoroughly part of the mission. Who, when, and where? Well, each Adventist Healthcare Corporation and the North American Division, at least, and perhaps the GC. 1 to 2 year program with periodic assignments and retreats. And then I would say after the so-called graduation of a certain time frame period, an ongoing formation program for graduates, if you will, and ideally a centrally located retreat center able to donate space and time. And gosh, what, Mark Stoddard, didn't you note that Centura would be happy to donate? Is that right?
My boss is correctly, Mark. So I'm not going to commit to anything like that. Okay.
Okay. Well, I just thought I'd call you out on that. So I loved what Carla said this morning. Look, connection and collaboration, and let's be honest with ourselves. Adventism has not done well in connecting and collaborating, not simply with others who are not us, but even ourselves. We seem to want to fight with each other more than connect with each other. And let me add then to Carla's words, not competition, but this goes back to that subculture. We as Adventists have been forever in competition with other faith traditions. And then as American business grew in a capitalist competition oriented way, and please don't mistake my comments, I'm as capitalistic and individualistic as the next guy. But it doesn't serve the public well. It doesn't serve ourselves well, and it's not oriented toward altruism and care for others. It's oriented toward egoism and self. And so these subcultures are at play in our current system, and I just hope that we can do what we can to help ease the edges of that and do it in common with each other. My final slide just poses some questions. What are the obstacles that would prevent us from working together? Generational differences. I think it's important for old guys like me to ask this question, not just generational, but gender issues, ethnic issues. How do we purposefully bring these in? I want to highlight Andy Lampkin and I worked together with Cisco at Advent Health on some online meetings about healthcare inequities. If we don't bake in formal ways to deal with healthcare inequities, we absolutely fail our communities and we fail our God. I can see no other way except to accept that premise. So what are the distinctions necessary to keep in mind between leadership formation and development, spiritual care, ethical leadership, and clinical ethics? And with that, let me stop sharing my screen. If I can figure out how to do that.
There we go. Top of your screen is a little button that says stop share.
Stop share. I have new share. Resume share. Stop share. Thank you.
Okay. Wow. I'm more technical than I knew.
And I'm less technical than I knew.
Peter, Mark, thank you very much for opening this conversation. And also want to thank Alex, Brian, and his team for teeing up our conversation so very, very well. I am sure that there are some questions. I didn't see too many in the chat as the conversation was going on, but I am looking for questions from our participants. So, Mark, as he was wrapping up, asked the question, what are the obstacles? Perhaps we could start there. What are the obstacles to introducing a systematized formation initiative that helps to create the connection, the buy-in, according to quote Marty and Blair, the buy-in necessary to communicate and convey the mission. I think it's important for us to recognize that we are the recipients of a really, really rich heritage of Christian caregiving. And we run the risk of drifting from that rich spiritual heritage of Christian caregiving if we are not careful to ensure that everybody who is asked to extend the healing ministry of Christ has not been properly prepared to do so. We have highly skilled clinicians and business people throughout all of our organizations, but many of those do not feel equipped to extend the healing ministry of Christ. Many join the organizations, join our ministries because of our mission statements. And I actually wanted to make reference to the birth of the Spiritual Ambassador Program, morphing into Spiritual Champions. That started at Florida Hospital and at Advent Health now. Someone joined the ministry because they wanted to live that out in their work experience, and they found that they were not supported in doing that. And so they complained to the then chief nursing officer, Connie Hamilton, who took steps to see that support was available for this individual to live out their desire to do mission at work. If we had an existing organized, systematized formation initiative, that individual would not have had to go to Connie Hamilton and say, I want to do mission, can I have permission to do it? They would have been taught how to do it coming in the door, and then they would have been able to live out and have their full person engaged in the work of doing mission. So I'm going to stop because I could pontificate on this all day, but I'd like to give others an opportunity to share. So we've got some questions coming in. Do the leaders from our several Adventist systems regularly meet together?
Oh, this is Carlisle. I'll be happy to answer that. As a matter of fact, tomorrow from 11 to 3, the leaders of our five Seventh-day Adventist systems will be meeting together in our spring Adventist Health Policy Association board meeting. Mm-hmm. Our devotional will be done by G. Alexander Bryant, the president of the NAD, and then there's dedicated time for him to have a conversation, sharing his vision and listening to how we can better collaborate. So, you know, as I listen to Peter, who I'm going to date right now, but Peter was my pastor when I attended Columbia Union College at Sligo Church. I wouldn't say what years those were, Peter challenged me back then in many of the things that he shared. And Mark, I totally concur with what you're saying, and many of the things that you articulated, that is a part of what we're seeking to accomplish within APA, because our systems are at varying levels of maturity in leadership development programs. For example, Advent Health has dedicated space and an Advent Health Leadership Development Center that they develop leaders in. But you are so correct that very often we compete and duplicate effort, And you're listening to a guy who has been a part of one of our systems for 35 years. But we spend a lot of time doing that when we can, I think, be a lot more effective in collaborating. One of the things tomorrow at our OPPA board meeting that we will hear about, there's an hour dedicated for Scott Reiner and Dr. Dexter Shermy from Adventist Health to talk about their well-being division and the well-being institute that they're seeking to establish. And instead of all of our systems spending resources to do these things, why not explore opportunities for centralization and collaboration? So this presentation resonates with me on many levels, and I know with the OPPA board, even though in my role, I've learned I never speak for our system CEOs, but I believe that they're committed to moving in this direction.
Thank you, Carlisle. I want to just highlight real quick on the tail end of your thoughts there that years ago when I was at the Center for Bioethics at Loma Linda, I was serving with Centura Healthcare. And at that point, it was and still is a Catholic Adventist venture. And one of the persons who joined us there told the story of the ministry center, and I've put a book in the margin or in the chat thread that tells the story of that center. And what he told us in short form at the meeting was that the bishops and archbishops challenged him and their healthcare corporations to do something to form their business leaders. And so he went and had a conversation with the CEOs of, I think, five Catholic healthcare corporations at the time. And he got their buy-in to be number one. He said he would not form a center unless they were willing to become his students. So they were part of the first cohort of the Ministry Leadership Center. And each of their systems put in $1 million to make that center happen. That was over 20 years ago. Profound story. I think it's incredible and inspiring.
Thank you for sharing that.
Okay.
I want to pose a question, Mark, if I may. These leadership programs that are developing, I was inspired by what Alex Brian reported earlier today. Tempted to see if I could get in on taking that course. It seems to me, and I would say this, Mark, about Mark Carr, about the collaboration. Back in the 1980s, I think it was, there was an attempt to create Adventist Health System US. Is there anybody else here old enough to remember that? In a sense, it felt like it was being imposed to create a structure for all of the systems. My recollection of it is it didn't work very well. It never really gelled as a nationwide system. And instead, what has been happening, and Carlisle, I think you represent this, the systems have been finding new ways to collaborate, OPPA being one of them, that didn't exist before. I don't know how old OPPA is. It's not probably more than 10 years old. And it seems to be flourishing. But this has grown up not because somebody imposed that, but because a need existed that could be addressed collaboratively. Frankly, I would see the Bioethics Consortium the same way. Mm-hmm. Is there a possibility for developing a division-wide leadership program that would have sufficient value so that all of the systems would choose to participate or not? Part of me would say, well, let's just, if Alex Brian has a good program, why don't we just all come? I was suggesting to him in the chat, maybe we all go to Sun River and I'll vote for that. I'm an Oregonian. We'll all show up there and you can lead out. Or maybe there is already a system in place that I don't know about. And the other question I have is really for Angeline Brower, if she's still with us, And that is, does the division have any role in facilitating that sort of thing? I heard Peter Landless say yesterday, well, maybe we need to convene more of these kinds of conversations. Yeah, who takes the lead in doing that? Whose job is that? Is that a GC job? I see Ken Denslow. Ken, we might nominate you. Maybe it's your job. But if it's everybody's job, it's probably not going to happen. So who would actually take the lead? Maybe it's Carlisle's job. Or maybe we all kind of just dream this up together. But I'm not sure at this point who would actually take the lead.
Jerry.
I meant that as a question, by the way.
Yeah, Jerry, this is.
Hi, Ken.
I'm just in the chat. I noticed Meredith Jobe's comment. To paraphrase Winston Churchill, our SDA health systems are five systems separated by a common religion. I had to point that out, Meredith. A great quote. I had hoped that we would have an opportunity to get Elder Bryant in today or yesterday even. Unfortunately, this week is just jam-packed and he was not able to. He will be with the CEOs tomorrow, however. But as you may or may not know, there's a new program. I'll call it a program that has just been voted by the NAD Executive Committee, a new emphasis, together in mission. And it really reflects the drive that Elder Bryant has for us to come together over mission. We may differ on some things, but on most things, we're not that far divided. And we're not so big that we don't need each other. Together in mission. He has a very much a big tent approach. As far as who starts the ball rolling for collaborative effort, not just between healthcare corporations, but between other entities. I think somebody mentioned this earlier, the three legs of the Adventist stool: education, healthcare, and congregational life. When I went to academy years and years ago, my school had a little sign out in front with a seal that said mental, manual, and moral, and there are variations of those all over, because we believe in the whole person. And so we've had schools to take care of the intellect, and we've had healthcare to take care of the physical, and we've had congregations that specialize in the spirit. But unfortunately, while we've emphasized the whole person, we haven't always emphasized the whole ministry. And that's what we're really needing to do. As far as this leadership center idea goes, man, we've been talking about that for a while. The reality is, on the church side, we are dying for lack of prepared leaders. People stumble and sometimes fall into leadership roles. They learn on the job. It has not been systematized. Now, some healthcare corporations have done that really, really well. I like the idea of maybe a leadership. And by the way, what the leadership vacuum that exists for the church also exists in the educational environment. There's a hue and cry for principals and visionary superintendents of education and so forth. But what if we approached leadership and had common leadership training where there is intersect? Obviously, there are parts of leadership that are going to be specific to each of those three disciplines. But I love the idea that Mark Carr presented to us, and I noted too that he's already assigned Mark Stoddard to work out the finances. So we're looking forward to seeing how this all plays out. Thank you very much.
Maybe that's a good note to end on. Thanks, Ken. One way or another, we can all chip in. But let me thank Mark Stoddard. Mark, we were only half kidding. If Sun River isn't available, there are places in Colorado we would consider. So maybe you can help us out. It's probably time to wrap up here, to keep our promises about respecting your time. I do want to thank all of the speakers and conveners for being so time conscious. This is one of those rare conferences where I think we've actually not been behind all the time we've been meeting. I want to share a couple of slides here as we come to an end, if I can find them. And the first one has to do with the next program that we will be helping to host. And as you can already tell, I'm not particularly good at this aspect of things. So let me find slideshow from the beginning. And is that working? Yes. And let me ask Grace Wee to comment on this, because Grace, you're helping to put this program together, and it's the next Adventist Bioethics Consortium program. And I think Russ Butler has been with us over these during the meeting.
Yeah, I'm enormously excited for this program. So I want to invite you to tune in if you're not able to make it. It'll be recorded and available on our website. You know, we've talked a lot at this conference about the need for more communication and dialogue. And in order to have productive communication and dialogue, we need to have good information and understand where our information comes from. And I think this presentation will be key to helping us understand the people and the communities that we serve. So please tune in.
Thank you. Thank you, Grace. And thanks for your leadership on this. I also want to mention, as I said before, that we're delighted that we've been welcomed by Advent Health to be their guests next year. May 2 and 3 are the chosen dates. We'll be at the Advent Health University, according to the plan that we've made. This is really getting back to a plan that we had a year ago, but had to postpone because of the pandemic. So for those of you who keep a calendar that reaches out to a year from now, let me just encourage you to write these dates down and save the date. Finally, I want to mention something that came up yesterday. This is just a photo from part of the website for the Adventist Bioethics Consortium, a course in clinical ethics for ethics committee members. It was put together some time ago and kept up by our friend and longtime colleague, Dr. Robert Orr. Some of you will remember Dr. Orr as one who presented to us about 3 years ago when we were meeting at the North American Division headquarters. I wanted to let you know that Dr. Orr has asked for our prayers as he comes to the final chapter of his life. He's on hospice care for end-stage cancer. And I would like to tell him that his name was mentioned here. For those of you who don't know Dr. Orr, you may want to get his book, Medical Ethics and the Faith Factor. It's a highly useful book if you're educating people about ethics. And for those who don't know about this course, it's right there available at no extra charge to those who are participating in the Bioethics Consortium. So I hope you will think about Dr. Orr and pray for comfort for him and his family. One thing that might make a connection for those of you even who don't know Dr. Orr is that he was a key mentor for Dr. Robert McCauley, who blessed us the last couple of days with keynote addresses. They were the two, Bob Orr and Bob McCauley are very close, and one more connection. And Dr. Orr is also the one who educated Grace Wee and Gina Moore and others who have led clinical ethics at our place at Loma Linda. So with that, let me just say again, I hope you'll save these dates, and let me close us out with a word of prayer of thanks to our Creator. Let's pray. Creator God, we do thank you for the many ways you bless us, the gift we have of a purpose. We've heard about asking the basic question, why? And whenever we get to that ultimate question, we find ourselves face to face with you and with our Lord Jesus. We ask that you will renew that sense of purpose in us every day and use the Bioethics Consortium as a vehicle for that. Now I pray that you will guide us through the days ahead as we continue to collaborate and seek faithfulness and in our leadership. I pray that in the name of Jesus, Lord and Savior. Amen. Again, thank all of you for joining us. Look for announcements for upcoming programs, including reminders about next year's conference.